knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
At this point in our study of archaeology, it's time to examine the exciting world of excavation, which is what many people probably imagine first when thinking about archaeologists. Excavation is the main way that archaeologists collect artifacts and record features, such as those we described in the previous few tutorials. Excavations can range in size, from small-scale digs of a certain feature to completely unearthing an entire site. Excavations are highly systematic and detailed, so that other archaeologists can look at excavation reports and perform analysis on them without having to physically be there. Setting up the systematic method of excavation at a site is critical before ground is broken. Archaeological sites are excavated using grids. Grid squares are 1 meter by 1 meter, and they are called excavation units. This grid is laid atop an imaginary plane, starting at the highest point of the site. If the grid was drawn straight on the surface, distances would be distorted by terrain. A total station is used to map this plane onto a site. Archaeologists are then able to geolocate each corner and orient the grid north. Often, string is used with stakes at the corner of each unit to denote the grid. This assures each grid is mapped the same in reference to the other grids. Once the units are mapped and marked, archaeologists can begin excavation. Units are excavated in levels, and at each level, the unit itself is level. Most excavations use 10-centimeter levels. Level 1 is often simply getting the surface to the same level. After this, the unit is carefully dug in 10-centimeter increments. The level in which an artifact was found will be recorded, as well as its X and Y coordinates in centimeters, and remember that each unit is 100 by 100 square centimeters. The dirt from each layer is also sifted to ensure that no small artifacts are missed. Artifacts are then collected and brought back to laboratories for analysis. Features and stratigraphic changes are also recorded. Munsells are used at each layer to determine which stratigraphic layer the level exists in. In the past, each level was hand-drawn with artifacts and features being drawn in. Recently, many archaeological excavations have begun using photos or 3D imaging to record levels. An excavation unit can be stopped for several reasons. A sterile layer, or a layer with no archaeological remains, was reached. Bedrock was reached, or a feature was reached, like the floor of a structure. After digging is complete on a unit, the profile or Z-axis of the unit is recorded. Like before, traditionally this was drawn, but photo capture is becoming more popular. This lets archaeologists record the stratigraphy of the surrounding units before they are excavated. At one excavation, many units are being dug at the same time, so coordination and organization are critical. We now know everything we need to be able to read excavation reports. These detail an excavation and provide maps of sites. Being able to interpret excavation reports is critical in understanding the data archaeologists use to make hypotheses about the ancient world. Let's analyze one together. We will be analyzing an excavation report from 1994 by Dr. Brian Redmond on a site from the state of Indiana in the USA called the Clampett Site. One of the first things that Dr. Redmond does is predict the time frame of the site. Some think you can't make testable predictions in archaeology, but this is not true. Dr. Redmond predicts the site to date from 1200 to 1500 based on the typologies of lithics and ceramics found at the site, as well as the architectural styles. As we will find out, radiocarbon dating validated this prediction. He also discusses survey techniques used to locate the site. It is generally good practice to not share the exact location of sites that are on private property to prevent trespassing and illegal digging. First, let's look at the excavation map on Figure 12. Each square is a meter by 1 meter unit, labeled with a letter. TR represents trenches, or long and skinny units used to find features and observe soil profiles. Let's zoom in on the section in Figure 13b. Here we can see the units as well as features found inside each one. Notice the palisade wall trench as well as post holes for structures. Since the Clampett site is a single occupation site, the map is fairly straightforward. However, when a site spans multiple levels, this can get more complicated, with several plans for the same units. Let's move on to soil profiles. This is the profile of Unit B in Figure 22. Notice how each layer correlates with a Munsell color. Two features, Feature 10 and Feature 11, sit on dark brown subsoil. Many of these features were middens containing charcoal. Five features in this level were radiocarbon dated, all giving dates from 1300 to 1450, as shown in Figure 38. This means that all features sitting atop this subsoil layer date to no older than 1300. Many alternate historians claim things like, this structure might be much older than we think it is. However, if we have a reliably dated layer that a feature sits on top of, the feature can't be older than that. Suppose we have a stone monument. We look for the lowest layer the feature inhabits to date it. If the soils under the feature are undisturbed, the feature cannot be any older than this layer. The builders couldn't have built the monument on a soil layer that didn't exist yet. We might find habitation on a site goes back farther than we thought, but that feature can't get any older. It can be younger than this level, having been pushed into the ground by the builders, but it can't be older. The layer the features date to likely has artifacts that fit into the typologies of the region. All these artifacts must also date to the period of construction for the feature due to the law of superposition, a date further strengthened by the serialization of the artifacts. Furthermore, the feature itself is usually associated with a style of feature present in many sites, which all corroborate a date range. It's with all these lines of data that archaeologists build evidence-based chronologies of sites. The excavation report goes more in-depth with many other unit profiles, artifact analysis, and more. The report can then be used by other archaeologists, perhaps noting how certain artifact types are found in certain areas of the site, or comparing the palisade wall to another at a similar site. Excavation reports are in-depth studies, often requiring an entire team of trained archaeologists to complete. Why do archaeologists put so much effort into recording everything during excavation? Well, unlike with most sciences, data recovery in archaeology is inherently destructive. Once a site is excavated, it and all the context it holds are gone forever. All that will be left are the archaeologists' records. Think how careful astronomers would be if stars they recorded exploded after being observed. This leads us to our next topic. Ethics in archaeology. Let's move forward and learn about this fascinating topic.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.